What's up, everybody? This is part 8 of the British Invasion series featuring the Who. What we're going to do here is a short little bio in the front, a feature of the Who, a highlight of one of their tunes, and then a little wrap-up commentary in the back. Okay, so let's get it, the Who.
Thank you very much.
Screaming fan girls.
What began as an invasion soon became an occupation. By the end of 1964, British music and British musicians were everywhere.
An occupation. Crazy.
Say you don't need a diamond ring, and I'll be satisfied.
Kids were out of control back then, man.
The money just can buy. Cause I don't care too much the money. Money can buy me love. Wow!
Kids were just losing their minds.
Do you have a ticket for the show tonight?
Yeah.
Well, are you going to the afternoon or evening performance?
The evening.
And who do you say lied to you?
The police, dear.
What did they tell you, honey?
They told us they'd come down there.
And they wouldn't let you come down here? Is that anything to cry over?
When you wait 2.5 years, dear.
Back in England, pop music had inspired a dazzling new culture.
Oh,
all roads now led to London, as the reign of a new pop aristocracy transformed England's capital into the swingingest city in the world.
So the invasion changed everything, man. Fashion, culture. Made a lot of people rich overnight. Taylor.
Out of this euphoric haze appeared the Who, Pete Townsend's group translated the mod preoccupations of swinging London into a musical style as distinctly original as Townsend's notorious Union Jack jacket.
We used to look to the States for everything, for our fashions and for our music. And then all of a sudden, you know, England's fashions and England's sort of music all sort of started to close in.
Those kids screamed their heads off. You notice the difference in the musicianship from the early to the mid-invasion? The Who, the Yardbirds. Musicianship really improved.
People in London started to like rhythm and blues, you know, which is essentially a good form of music. Groups started to play it, and there was an audience for rhythm and blues. The English group music thing also arose, where groups not only were performing their own stuff compact on the stage, they didn't need anyone else, they just had the four blokes with their amplifiers, guitars, and they could do the lot.
The Who are just sort of like in that catalytic converter of rock and roll. They were maybe the most explosive musical unit. Yeah, it was interesting. The Beatles all lock in and play together and help each other. The Who is like four different creatures who aren't even like noticing each other. Everyone in The Who was like the lead player in The Who.
It's part of their charm.
All these great bands created this thirst in music, but the ones that really had the true, true talent have really stood the test of time.
That was a cool Union Jack jacket. All right, man. So that's part one of the Who bio. So let's do Who feature, and then we'll hit part two of the Who bio. So the Who feature number one, let's get it.
Smile as I ransack their homes. they wanna shake my hand. Focusing on nowhere, investigating miles. I'm a seeker, I'm a really desperate man.
Good singer. Yeah, great improvement musicianship wise from the early to the mid invasion.
I won't get to get what I'm after till the day I die. I learned how to raise my voice in anger. Yeah, but look at my face, ain't this a smile?
Drummer solo.
We're looking at each other and we don't know what to do. They call me the seeker. I've been searching low and high.
Bass player is nice and calm and cool, and everybody else seems to have jumping beans in their pockets. Good. The crowd is nice and civilized, just dancing and enjoying themselves. Yeah, I guess by the mid-60s, once the Who came on the scene, it was a little bit more toned. Those teens were now in their late teens, and they've had a great amount of exposure from the Beatles to the Hollies to all of the earlier British invasion bands, so they were settled within themselves, knowing that the sound of the British invasion was there to stay, and it was evolving a little bit. So in that crowd, they're civilized, they're dancing, they're enjoying themselves, they've had enough exposure, I guess. And notably, I really like the fact that as time progressed with the arrival of the Yardbirds and then the Who, I noticed the musicianship really improved. And that's really excellent. So that definitely paved the way also for other acts to follow them. And as those acts started showing, the ones who really had the best staying power, as I can tell, are the ones who had good musicianship. The ones who had a little bit more than just good looks. Had a little bit more than just, just a basic jingle to carry them along. So a number of them died off once the rush of the British invasion started to wane. And the ones who were true musicians, they're the ones who stayed, you know, the Beatles, the Stones, the Who, the Yardbirds. So only the ones that were really, I don't know, I hate to say the words, true musicians, kind of endured and stayed, you know. That might be an ignorant statement. Let me know. Maybe I'm a little bit off there, but that's just what I'm seeing. Okay, man, let's finish off the Who bio here. And then we'll have a wrap-up commentary.
By the end of 1967, England's domination of both the American and British music scenes had come to an end. But the British contributions that had made rock and roll a worldwide force would not be forgotten. New trends would come and go, but never again, perhaps, with the innocence and vitality of the original British invasion.
Times changed quickly from 64 to 67. Right. Yeah. Yeah, that's what they were famous for, their stage antics and breaking things. So now it's just the drummer, and that cool, calm bass player is the last one there. What a stage act, man. The Who. Yeah, you know, man. Those stage antics, there's no way. If they had come along in like 64, like when the Beatles started, there's no way that they would have been allowed to act that way. So within a few short precious years, from 64 to 67, things had really changed so much. Everything was toned down. The kids weren't screaming and losing their minds anymore. They were a little older and mature. And I imagine that the culture and things changed so quickly, it allowed for bands like The Who to have this over-the-top kind of persona. And, you know, I know that recreational drugs were being ushered in and used more. It was approaching the, the year of love, the whole flower power thing. So there's a lot going on culturally that changed and allowed for The Who's antics like that. But back in 64, they would never have been allowed to do that. But I know that's a part of their charm. It's a part of their act. It's one of those elements that set them aside from everybody else. And I imagine that image-wise, they wanted to distance themselves from any kind of previous acts, especially like the early Beatles era music. They wanted to be distinct enough to separate themselves from the Stones, you know. So they definitely had a persona all their own. And one thing that I really liked, I would call it the midpoint of the British invasion, where they came along with the Yardbirds, is the musicianship. The quality of the musicianship really improved. And I said before, and maybe it's an ignorant thing that I'm saying, but it seems to me that the ones who stuck around after the rush of the invasion are the ones who had better musicianship, and also the ones who were capable within the structure of their own groups to write their own songs, to have a creative element. There wasn't an outside element doing your writing for you, doing your creating for you. I mean, let's face it, you know, once the Beatles broke through, and a lot of these promoters saw dollar signs. I mean, I don't blame them. If I was a promoter, I would shake my ass over to England, get a couple of kids that looked like the Beatles, who could, you know, strum a few chords and kind of create some sort of a sound, and then push them into the forefront. Man, that was a get-rich-quick scheme if I'd ever seen one, right? So, but a lot of those acts, though, didn't have much else to go on once time started to kind of change things. And now the fallout is what you see. Who's left standing are the Beatles, the Stones, the Who, just a couple of few from the many. And I think the separation factor definitely is their musicianship and their ability to create their own music, right? And to steer their own path. Some of them fell by the way of bad management. The Kinks is a good example. I mean, they were young too. They were like 16, 17. But if they had better management and a better direction, they would have definitely stuck around in America and been a lot more influential than what they were. They maintained, they had staying power, they had creative elements, they had all of those good things. But one thing that failed them definitely was management. So they're an exception to the rule. It's not like they didn't have talent and longevity. They just had, they were just dealt a bad card. So not the best example I can think of. But anyway, my point being is that the ones who stuck around after the invasion, during what I call the occupation now, are the ones who had musical talent and the ability to create their own music source. Definitely. That's what I see. Very, very important note here. So I mentioned earlier that I was going to do a follow-up, kind of like an honorable mentions medley after the Who bio. And everything seemed fine where it came to sourcing out. So as you're watching this right now, the update is that between the time that I sourced out the little video clips from the different sources of my honor mentions medley to now, I'm not able to upload it. YouTube is not allowing it for some reason. It was fine when I kind of sourced it out and kind of did my little test run. It sat there and the algorithm was fine with it, but for some reason, a couple of days later, it's just not being allowed. So that honorable mentions medley that I was promising is just not going to happen. What a difference just a few days make. I can't understand or explain why. But so those little honorable mentions are not included at the end of the Who clip. Sorry if it's disappointing to some. But a lot of that, there were bands from both segments of the British Invasion time slot, the early and the mid, along with the Beatles and Jerry and the Pacemakers. There came the Zombies and the Dave Clark Five. And so there were a number of other smaller bands, Herman's Hermits. So a couple of those were included in my honorable mentions medley. But sadly, it's just not being allowed for some reason. Maybe it's the way it was constructed together. Maybe it's because it's a shorter piece. I just don't understand what happened there. If you guys have a better idea, let me know. But I'll remember that. No more honorable mentions or little clips or medleys. It just doesn't seem to work on YouTube. Anyway, man, that's the update. So getting back to the Who, I really like how not only did they have a great creative element, they of course had a great stage show and everything like that. They had lasting power and they had great musicianship. Say what you will about them, they had the elements to stay and thrive. The Beatles the same, the Stones the same, and then they helped to usher in the way for other British acts to now follow. Not an invasion anymore, but an occupation. Now it's an institution that definitely has staying power. So the acts that were being scouted and brought over now, you knew that these people had really good, strong elements of staying power. Cream, David Bowie, Led Zeppelin, Queen. So these really, really great bands came over that had fantastic musicianship, great songwriting and creativity, and they were so much different than the early British Invasion kind of way out kind of bands where they come and they just go. So I like that whole transition arc from beginning to mid to the end point, the end point turning from invasion into occupation. This series has been very, very good in the sense of teaching me a couple of things, especially the contribution factor of the British acts. The British Invasion was such an important part of the history of music. It affected everything, and not just the music, it affected culture, fashion. There are lots of music speaking about social and political issues. So yeah, man, I'm really happy that I had the time to look into this a little bit further. I learned a lot, and I have a deeper appreciation now for music on a whole, not just coming from the British segment, but coming from all areas, especially back in that time area. Speaking about that time area, I'm going to do like a contrast, a series called The History of Rock and Roll, and it's more specifically focusing on the American side, you know, the Elvis, Chuck Berry's, Little Richard's, Jerry Lee Lewis, and some of those pioneering acts that helped to usher in that music element, and setting that stage for the classic rock of the 70s. So, and you know, I mean, that's the stuff that I'm doing a lot of reactions to now. So I'm going to focus on that, and it's primarily the acts coming from the American side. So look for that in the next little bit. I'm not quite sure when I'm going to get to that, in a couple of weeks probably. So anyway, man, thanks for joining me. I hope that you like this series. And if there's anything else in the British invasion that I might have missed that you feel that I should cover, let me know and I'll jump into it, you know, and maybe do an add-on, maybe episode 9 or whatever the case may be. But for now, that's a wrap for the British invasion. So thanks for joining me, man. And look for my next series coming up called The History of Rock and Roll. Take care. Peace.